Not working? Okay. Okay. I'm going to tell you the story of a special garden. This garden is in Kuala Lumpur, at a shopping mall. This is the largest shopping mall in Malaysia and one of the largest in the world. What's amazing about this shopping mall is not what's inside, which is quite typical, it's what's, it's what's on top. On the roof, we have created a special garden, which took us 5 years to do. And because it was on the roof, it was invisible to the public. We took 5 years to test out a lot of concepts and some new materials. And the staff of the developer knew something was going on, but they didn't know what. So they called this, it was some kind of a garden. So they referred to it among themselves as the secret garden of their boss. So the name stuck. It became the secret garden of one Utama. On this garden, we have created a series of landscapes. We have hot spots, sunny hot spots, flower beds, waterfall, mystery tunnels, and in the humid tropics, gardens are typified by having large, fleshy green leaves. So we try to emphasize this because we are a tropical garden. So we look for nice, fleshy leaves to put into this garden. But a tropical garden, if you leave it to itself, is normally a very green garden. So we want to put color in the garden, and we do this by putting in, colorful leaves, colorful stems, and we put in a lot of flowers. Flowers, plants that flower throughout the year, like bougainvilleas, morning glories, calatheas. We went too fast. Bird of paradise flower, Rangoon creeper. And so we are on the way to, we're actually a garden that is in which it is springtime all the time, no matter which time of the year you come to visit. And the garden is open to the public, free of charge, every weekend and public holidays. In order to help educate people, youngsters, children in Kuala Lumpur, we grow a lot of food plants. For example, pepper. We grow coffee, all the three major kinds of coffee, Arabica coffee, Robusta coffee, as well as Liberica coffee. We also grow cocoa, food plants like tapioca, papayas, and of course rice, and a whole lot of other things. We also try to demonstrate the use of what we call architectural plants, plants that have very distinctive architecture, like this Canary Island palm. This is the largest specimen grown in Malaysia, I think, and is able to grow on the rooftop. I'll tell you why later. Here's another architectural plant. This is one of the century plants that flower maybe after 10 years, and then they die. Feels like a century. Cacti have very remarkable, interesting shapes. Now, in the tropics, if you don't look after your garden, you don't prune it regularly every week, your garden turns into a jungle. So we have to do a lot of work pruning the garden every week. And this particular plant needs a haircut twice a week. Okay, now for the technical parts of the garden. What are the secrets? No, there are no secrets, actually. The garden's open. You can use a camera. Nobody's going to stop you. You can ask any questions. Of course, you'll have to find somebody who can give you the answer. But we do have guided tours every month. Okay. A student came to see me last month. He came from, he was doing landscape architecture, and he came with a whole list of prepared questions. And all his questions were to try and find out what are the plants that will grow on the rooftop. He thinks that's the secret, that the plants that grow up here must be something special. And I said, no, anything you can grow on the ground, you can grow on the rooftop. It all depends on the interests and the capability of your designer and the garden curator. But the most often asked question is actually, how deep is the soil? Now, the soil is 12 inches deep. Why does this keep jumping? Okay. No. It's 12 inches deep. That's all there is, and we find that we can grow anything here. What limits the plants is the wind. We don't want anything that will catch the wind, because this is 7 stories above the ground. So we try to keep everything about that size. The other important thing is the weight on the roof. Now, this building was not designed for a garden. There is no special reinforcement. This is an ordinary roof. So we have to make sure that the loading is correct. And to give you an idea, the maximum loading is equal to 2 feet depth of water. So our water lily pond is 1.5 feet. So we do have a good safety margin. This is, by the way, the Amazon water lily. The other technical question that people are very concerned about is, will the roots break the roof? Now, let's make it very clear here. Plant roots are not drills. They cannot drill into solid concrete. What they do is they find a crack in the concrete. So your roof is already defective. It's got a crack. Then it will grow into the crack, and then it will widen the crack. So if the roots are trapped between two walls or against a wall, it can push, and it may break your wall. In this case, the roots are underground. And when they grow bigger and bigger, they lift the pavement, and your pavement can crack. But on the secret garden or on any rooftop, your roots are on top of the concrete. And if your roof is properly built, it will not. The roots cannot harm your concrete rooftop. The real secret of the garden is this. It's called biochar. It's actually charcoal. Charcoal that's been broken up into fine pieces. And as you can see, it's very easy for water and air to go through this because the particles are about 1 centimeter and there are a lot of gaps in between. So people forget that plants need water and, very important, they need fresh air. Our normal soils are very clayey, very tight, very compact. And after a while, you'll find that if you don't loosen your soil by cultivation, your plant roots begin to suffer. Now, we use biochar. sometimes 100%, and in other places 50% mixed up with normal earth. And this makes a very friable, loose medium, the bottom of which is always wet because water goes in and it has to move out to the sides. It takes quite a long time, it takes a whole day. So we water every day, so the bottom part is moist and the top part is very open and airy. So the plant roots find their own level of comfort. And because of this, we are able to grow a lot of things that are very difficult to grow on the in a normal soil, like hydrangeas, hostas. And now I will come to a very special feature of the biochar that we use. We are very concerned about climate change. And climate change is due to global warming. And global warming is caused by the increase in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Now, where did this carbon dioxide come from? They come from the burning of fossil fuels, petroleum and coal. How did the carbon get in there? Well, petroleum and fuel are the remains of plants and animals from millions of years ago. Because the plant body and the animal body stores carbon. And when they get fossilized, this carbon is kept. Now, but because we use all these fossil resources to create energy, all our electricity, most of our electricity comes from the burning of coal. And also, and our traffic, vehicular traffic, our aeroplanes come from the burning of petroleum. So all this carbon from ages, a long time ago, that have been locked up underground are now being poured back into the atmosphere. And all this talk about trying to control climate change, to control global warming, is concentrated on how to save energy, to use less energy, so that we don't keep on adding carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. There's very little talk about how to get the carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and store it. The best mechanism on land for storing carbon is forest, because the plants absorb carbon dioxide and the trees store the carbon dioxide in the form of wood. So the forest function in taking carbon dioxide from the air, but the forests are gradually diminishing, they're slowly disappearing. And when wood is cut and converted to use, they eventually rot. And the carbon dioxide returns to the air. So it's not a good form of storage. It's not a permanent form of storage. The other thing is that the storage ability of a forest reaches a maximum after a while. They absorb carbon dioxide most actively when they're young and growing. But as they age and reach a maximum, they stop being effective. So the carbon storage will reach a maximum at about 300 micrograms of carbon per hectare. You can translate that to 300 tons per hectare. But even that's difficult to imagine. So let us try and change all this into charcoal. How much charcoal is there in a tropical rainforest? Most of the forest is actually water, just like our human bodies. You get rid of the water, get rid of the nitrogen, get rid of all the other things, and you end up with 2.5 inches of charcoal if you spread it out evenly on the floor. 2.5 inches. In the secret garden, we have 12 inches of soil. Now, if it's 100%, that means that we are holding 5 times as much carbon as the forest that used to be there. If we use 50% biochar, we are storing 2.5 times. Just think of the implications. That means that a building, by transferring the ground up to the top, can actually continue to serve as a carbon storage mechanism to compensate for the forest that it replaces, and even more than compensate. And so this carbon storage method is something that you and I can use in our own gardening activities. And the size of the garden doesn't really matter, because you can do it on the rooftop of your own house if you build a house. And I have a friend who has built a flat roof bungalow, and he uses the roof for his very special gardening activities. He happens to be a plant breeder. He develops new kinds of plants, so he wants to have his garden quite secret. But it doesn't have to be a garden. It can be an organic farm, because on the top of a high-rise building, you're isolated from the ground and isolated from other sources of contamination. You can keep it free of pests and diseases to a very large extent. It can also be a butterfly farm. It can be all sorts of other things. It can be a lawn. It can be a paddy field. I grow paddy on the secret garden. And my gardeners were in their former lives paddy farmers. And they used to laugh at me, you know, in the beginning. They say, oh, you can't grow paddy on this stuff. It needs tanah liat, muddy soil. And they were shocked when they found a bumper crop of rice coming up from biochar. And the birds that eat paddy have discovered our place, and they're now regular visitors on the rooftop. And we now grow the paddy for the birds. Otherwise, they have nothing to eat. And so the take-home message is that the rooftop of our cities, the rooftops, do not have to be sterile, ugly places. They can be livable environments, and they can help to improve the environment, the urban environment, and make a strong contribution towards the amelioration of the climate. Thank you. Mm-hmm.